Jesus, Holy Spirit of God, you're teaching us, bringing us information, knowledge, understanding, wisdom. So we can live right, so we can do right. Hearts and our minds are open. Let your word come to our spirit in strength and power. I wish you'd do that which you've called us and chosen us to do. Thank you, O Lord. Praise God. Hallelujah. How's your day? Tonight we will continue with our series on seed faith. You know, we're going to learn some things. And remember, we learn God's word so we can put it to work, so we can live by it. The word of God is good for us, so we can practice it, so we can do the word. Ready? I want us to read from St. Luke's Gospel, chapter number 6. Read the words of the Lord Jesus Christ in the 38th verse. Oh, hallelujah. To know that we can walk in the blessings of God unlimited. Remember, I told you why we started this series. Okay. 38 verse, 6th chapter of St. Luke's Gospel. It says, "Give and it shall be given unto you. Good measure, pressed down and shaken together, and running over, shall men give into your bosom. For with the same measure that ye meet withal, it shall be measured to you again. Give and it shall be given unto you. Good measure, pressed down and shaken together and running over." In other words, full to overflowing. Hallelujah. "For with the same measure that ye meet withal, it shall be measured to you again." Someone said, the hole through which you give is the hole through which you get. That's another way of saying the same measure that you meet, it shall be measured to you again. We're talking about seed faith. Again, what is seed faith? It means applying your faith with the principle of the life of the seed. Applying your faith with the principle of the seed life. That's seed faith. Seed faith. Understanding that this was the way that Jesus Christ applied his faith. He applied his faith with the same principle that the seed life lives by. How it works. That it works. See, how a seed functions. Number one, a seed has to be sown in good ground. If you put it anywhere else, it will not produce. The seed must be sown. Number two, the seed will produce its kind. I'm talking about the principle of the seed life. First, it must be sown. Secondly, it can only produce its kind. The seed can only produce its kind. Thirdly, it'll produce a harvest of what you sow. In other words, it'll multiply back to you what you sow. The seed will come back to you multiplied in the harvest. This is the principle of the seed life. And this is the way that Jesus Christ applied his faith in every situation. He applied his faith the way the seed functions. So this is the reason we're calling it seed faith. Hallelujah. Seed faith. The way you apply your faith. The way the seed functions. It must be sown. It must go. It must be sown. Number two, it can only produce the same kind. And number three, it will multiply back in coming to you. So when you apply your faith with the understanding of the principle of the seed life, you are working with seed faith. And that means you will get the Bible result. Do you understand now? Praise the Lord. Sometimes people want a formula for getting things from God, but it's not that way. You don't need a formula. You just need to know how Jesus lived. What did he do? What did he say? And then put his word to work. Hallelujah. Okay, so number one, are you ready? Okay, Jesus said here, give and it shall be given unto you. Paul the Apostle quotes Jesus, and we don't find where exactly Jesus said that, except to know that Paul encapsulated this verse in the 6th chapter of St. Luke's Gospel. That's the 38th verse that we read, to let us know what Jesus said. So let's read it. Book of Acts, 20th chapter. Oh, hallelujah. If you would just put this to work in your life, you would see wonders. It works in every area. It works for anything and everything. And it'll work for anybody. Hallelujah. Anybody. 35th verse of the 20th chapter of the book of Acts. Are you ready? I read. I have showed you all things, how that so laboring ye ought to support the weak, and to remember the words of the Lord Jesus, how he said, quote, it is more blessed to give than to receive. Now, when you study Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, you will not find any verse that is so stated where Jesus said, it is more blessed to give than to receive. Yet Paul says Jesus said it. And we know that when Jesus walked the streets of that nation of Israel, Paul the apostle was not there. Isn't that true? He was not with Jesus. So, what is he referring to? He is referring to something that Jesus said, and we can get it here in the 38th verse of the sixth chapter in Luke's gospel where Jesus said, "Give and it shall be given unto you. Good measure, pressed down, shaken together, and running over, shall men give unto your bosom," into your bosom. Which means that when we give, what we give is multiplied back to us. Hello? We can only have the blessing for our giving, not for our getting. In other words, it is what we give that is multiplied back to us, not what we get. What we get is not multiplied to us. What we get is what we get. But what we give, praise God, comes back multiplied to us. He said, "Give and it shall be given unto you." In what? In good measure, pressed down, shaken together, and running over. And he says, "Shall men give into your bosom?" In other words, whether or not they want to give to you is not the issue. Somebody is going to give to you. Hallelujah. The one who said it will cause them to give to you. Now, have you ever found somebody who never got anything from anybody? Let me read someone like him to you. He has a friend in the Bible. You want to know him? It's in St. Luke's Gospel, 15th chapter. I'm going to read pretty quick, all right? So you try to follow. Some things I want to get for you. We've studied this before, but I want to refresh your pure minds. 11th verse, 15th chapter, St. Luke's Gospel. And he said, Jesus said, "A certain man had two sons, and the younger of them said to his father, 'Father, give me the portion of goods that followed to me. Give me my inheritance,' he said. And he divided unto them his leaving. And not many days after, the young son gathered all together and took his journey into a far country, and there wasted his substance with riotous living. And when he had spent all," I want you to mark, "spent all." The guy gave nothing to nobody. He spent all. The Bible says he what? Spent all. Say, spent all.
Spent all.
Say it again. Spent all. The man spent everything that he had. He had his inheritance and he spent all. He didn't give to nobody. He spent everything. Good. Well, let's read that verse. "And when he had spent all, there arose a mighty famine in that land, and he began to be in want." He spent everything that he had until he got into want when there was a famine in the land. "And he went and joined himself to a citizen of that country, and he sent him into his fields to feed swine." He joined himself to a citizen of that country. He wanted a job, and the man gave him a job to feed swine. Now, hey, he got a job. He spent everything. Now, just because somebody spent everything doesn't mean he's not going to get a job. He can get a job. He got a job. But it's never God's intention for anybody to live on his job. Oh, I've been trying to get this point across to you. Don't make a living out of your job. Don't say, "My job, this is where I make my living." No, you're wrong. That's not the principle of the Word of God. You are wrong. Oh, Pastor Chris, how do you know that's wrong? It's wrong because God said to Adam, "Out of your sweat you shall eat bread." Somebody said, "Yeah, but that's where it started." No, God changed things. That's to let us know that was not God's intention from the beginning. That came as a result of the sin of the man. He said, "Out of your sweat shall you eat bread." and the land will bring you thorns and thistles, till you return to the land, for dust thou art, and unto dust shalt thou return. But later on, God changed things. He said, I will not curse the ground no more. And now, what did he do? He blessed the man he talked to. He's talking to Noah and his sons. The Bible says he blessed them. And said, now you go. Everything he told Adam at the beginning, every good thing that he told Adam at the beginning, now he told Noah and his sons. So the man was blessed with his family. So the blessing had come back. Noah wasn't going to live his life according to the sweat of his body. But God gave Adam a job before. Don't forget it. Hey, he brought Adam one day. Remember, Adam was not always in the garden. Oh, come on here. Read your Bible. It says, God made a garden. And after he had made the man, he put him in the garden. The man was not made in the garden. God had a garden. And so when he was through with the man, the Bible says he put the man that he had made in the garden. And when the man woke up in the garden, hey, everything was already in place. And then God said, I want you to take charge of the garden. I want you to keep it, dress it, make it good. And you can eat anything you want here except from that tree over there. Don't eat of it. Why? Because it was not time. Somebody say, yeah, I put it there to tempt him. No, he didn't put it there. God doesn't tempt anybody with evil. Neither is he tempted with evil. He put it there because it was not time to eat of it. The time would come and man would eat of it so he can judge the devils. Because it was called the tree. It was called the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. Now, when Adam was made, he didn't know anything evil. Everything he knew was good. The only thing Adam knew was something good. He didn't know nothing about evil. He only knew God and gods. That is, things that belong to God. Until one day, the devil came in and said, hey, you can't trust God. And he did what God said not to do. And what happened? His eyes opened. Every time you listen to the wrong stuff, your eyes open. What kind of eyes? The wrong eyes open. Have you heard? And then they tell you what you shouldn't have heard. What happens? You start seeing in a new light now. Have you heard that sister so-and-so is this? Have you heard that brother so-and-so is this? You always respected sister so-and-so. You always respected brother so-and-so. You saw them through the eyes of God until the devil came and said, you can't trust them. Then you started seeing afresh. Nothing happened to them. You got naked. The Bible says the eyes of them both were open and they found out they were naked. And God said, Adam, where art thou? He said, Lord, I hid myself because I found out I was naked. And God said, who told you? God never told you. God said, did you do something? Did you do what I said don't do? Yeah. It's this lady over here. The Lord said, lady, what did you do? She looked around and said, the serpent did. God said, serpent, you can't talk. You are cursed. Praise God. Hallelujah. See, so God didn't intend for us to work and work and work and then live from hand to mouth and live according to our job. No, sir. God gave the man the job so he could take care of his world, dress the world. Come on, take care of the garden. And after taking care of the garden, you remember he said, have dominion over the fish of the sea and the fowl of the air and the beasts of the field, everything. I don't believe that God intended that Mr. Adam should live in a nest in the tree for all his life. He gave him a garden so he could take some rest, begin from here, because he told him the whole world is before you, it's all up to you. Then he said, have dominion over everything. Man has exercised dominion today over everything. over the metals, over the plants, over the air about around him, over everything. And so we are enjoying all this today. Praise God. But with a price. With a price. All because of sin. With a price. We make a motor car. It's wonderful. And so now we can move from point A to point B speedily. And then there's an accident. The guy dies. With a price. There's an airplane. It's wonderful. Everybody likes it. Big jumbo jet. And then we get in. And then they go. And then they say, well, they didn't know where the thing went to. They build houses. Oh, it's so wonderful. It burns up with a price. Every good thing that man makes comes with a life price. There's death in everything that he does. Everything. There's death in it. Are you still there? See? So, God gave the man a job. See? So he could work there and take care of the garden and take care of his world. Have a sense of responsibility and work like God. Hallelujah. But God said, hey, see, God didn't say, now Adam, when you're, now that you're in the garden, you're gonna have to plant this and plant that because you're gonna, this is the only way you're gonna eat. No, the food was there already. He said, of any tree in the garden thou mayest eat. I want to remind you that outside the garden, there were trees. There were fruit trees as well. I'd like to remind you, outside that garden, there was so much that Adam could eat. So everything that he needed was not just all that he had in the garden. Anything he wanted, he could have. If he wanted to eat outside the garden, he could. For the whole world was before Adam. Read your Bible. But see, God intended that wherever you are working, you can be blessed from there. So he gave him a job and he didn't muscle the ox that treaded the corn. Are you here? So, that's exactly what's going on today. When you are working somewhere, they can give you something. But there's a lot outside. Hallelujah. Praise God. You say, how'd you know? Hey, remember one day God said to Adam, get out of here. Get out of the garden. You've messed up. Get out. All right. Did he come out and say, oh God, there are no trees out here. No, there's a lot of trees out there and he had something to eat. Come on, talk to me now. See. So, God never intended for you to make a living out of your job. But he wants everybody to work. He wants you working. No, he doesn't want any dummies. He won't sponsor no flops. God is good. Amen. Amen. He wants you doing the right thing. Okay, let's come back here. God will multiply back to you what you give. He wants to. It's his principle. So you make a living. Get it. You make a living out of your giving. That's the idea. Hey, if you haven't understood that before, from tonight, start practicing it. And you watch your own life grow. You make a living out of your giving. See why you must start teaching your children from the beginning how to give, how to learn to give. So they grow up knowing it. Do you know that's what the Bible teaches? You make a living out of your giving. You want to continuously have in your life. You have to be a continuous giver. Then it doesn't stop. When you stop the flow. Told him a story in the afternoon. The man This will lead us into the next point. The next point is, God is your source. Oh, get it, get it, get it, get it. God is your source. Your daddy is not your source. Your mom is not your source. Your husband is not your source. Your wife is not your source. The government is not your source. You'd be wrong. Your company is not your source. Your children in America, they are not your source. Get it for all time. If you make man your source, you are sunk. This is this man, he was a farmer. He lived on his fruits. He had a lot of fruit trees, beautiful fruit trees. He prided himself in what he had, and he was a wonderful man, a nice man. He had good friends, and his business was big because he was thriving on these fruits. And they sent him in for processing, and he had become a big shot in town for his business. Then he always took good care of the fruits, and they were wonderful, beautiful fruits. Year after year they came in for the harvest, truckloads, they bore them away. And then one day he came to a point where he didn't have anything anymore. The fruits were gone. The trees were gone. The business was gone. And now the money was gone. He was down. And people wondered, hey, what happened to you? Like what we see from time to time, things that have happened to people around us. We know that something, you'll almost have to be blind not to know that many people have found themselves in that case in our country. People who used to prosper, and they don't prosper anymore, they don't have money anymore. I mean, things just gone upside down for them. The story is so much around us. There's too many people like that. So this was the man's case too. But I want to tell you something. They made the same mistake like this man. So one day, the man found out what his problem was. And he talked to someone else. And that's how the story came out. What was the problem? He said, one year, I came to the trees and they didn't produce as much as they used to. Not as much as they did the previous year. And then the next year, it was worse. I didn't have enough fruits, not like I used to. And the following year, it was worse. Just wondering what's going on. By the time I tried to change things, it was too late. Business was gone. What was wrong? He said, I found out I was wrong about my source. I thought the fruits were my source. I took care of the fruits. Every year when I got them, I washed them, and I called people to see how beautiful my fruits were. I prided myself in how big they were. I took care of them. I watched over them. I stored them. But I didn't take good care of the trees from where I got the fruits. I took more care of the fruits than the trees. The fruits I thought were my source. And since I didn't take care of the trees got bad. And they got bad. And then they couldn't produce as much anymore. And they went worse and worse until it was too late. Then he said, but I'm going to start all over again. I've decided to take a course. and how to treat them. Treat them good. Are you still out there? He was mistaken about his source. He thought the fruits were his source. How many of us have made the same mistake in life? We didn't recognize the source. We worship the means. We even worship the means. We worshiped our job, our business. We gave it all the time in the world we got. Only to find out that company was just the means through which God blessed me. It was just the instrument that God used. God is your source. You don't have time for God, but He's your source. Even in ministry, it's the same thing. Sometimes we can get busy. We can get busy, 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 busy. So busy. We can't pray. We can't study. We're too busy. We're busy with follow-up. We're busy with so many things. Preparing the sermons. We're so busy. We got to visit. And then we got to supervise. And we got to work. We got to do this. We got to do that. And then we neglect the source. God is your source. If you stop the flow, you may find out too late. Jesus cursed the tree. You remember Jesus cursed the tree, the fig tree. The Bible says that one day he wanted figs and then he was hungry. So when he got to the tree, he didn't find figs. So he said, tree, nobody's going to eat fruit from you from this day forward. And the Bible says the disciples heard it. They made a mental note of it. Because they looked at the tree and it was the same as it was before Jesus talked. Well, they thought, hey, when he talks to blind eyes, they open up. When he talks to deaf ears, they get unstopped. When he talks to the lame, they get up and walk. He talks to the dead and dead comes out of the grave. Now he talks to the tree don't change. So they made a mental note. Today, Master made a mistake. He talked to tree, and tree didn't change. That whole day, it was the same. The Bible declares, the next morning, as they passed by, Peter, you know Peter, he won't let Jesus off the hook. And I can imagine he was excited that they're going through that street. But lo and behold, Peter looked. The tree. The Bible doesn't just tell us that the tree withered. It says it was dried up from the roots. It came from the ground. The Bible says, Peter calling to remembrance, said unto him, Master, behold, the fig tree which thou cursest is withered away. Another writer says, how soon is the fig tree withered? How soon? But they saw it yesterday. Nothing happened yesterday. Oh, something happened yesterday. You just didn't see it. It was happening in the ground right from the source of its life was dead. But it's under the ground, so you can't tell. Right? It's in the ground, so you can't tell. So you look at the leaves, still green. And you say, well, Jesus, you missed it this time around. But they came next day, and it was all gone. What do I mean by that? Sometimes, you see, when you stop the flow, it's not immediately obvious. When you neglect your source, it's not immediately obvious because you're still living on the flow that's been given out already. And so it's still coming, but you don't know. Hey, brother, you're just about on the last count. This one is about to dry up. This is the last flow because you already stopped it from the source. So what are you going to do? God is your source. You have to remember that now. You have to act on it now. God is your source. He's your source. Get excited about your source. Hallelujah. There are people who used to be givers in their lives, but they're not givers anymore. Why? Because they said, a lot of people wanted to cheat me. I've learned a lot of bad, hard lessons. So I'm not going to let myself, I'm not naive anymore. I'm not going to, hey, no giver is naive. Make no mistakes about it. Hey, they're not naive. Huh? You think, there are people who are stingy, you know, they don't give nothing. They are the collectors. They always take from everybody. They take, and then they laugh. They say, I got it from them. They say, I told him something. And they're happy I lied to him, and then he gave it to me. I took it. You know what you're doing? You are biting a bad apple. Sure. You can't cheat a giver. You'll be wasting your time. Judas Iscariot, he was a treasurer. And every time when he took money out of it, he declared for his friends outside. You know, and they said, how are you working with that miracle man? He said, well, the miracles are for all of us. As they work miracles on the sick, I work miracles on the bag. So he was always excited, carrying the bag for Jesus. And the Bible says the master knew that Judas always stole from the bag. And Jesus never said anything to Judas about it. He just let him steal. Jesus, you can't lock him out. Oh, I feel sorry for Judas. Lock the doors. Jesus will be right inside with you. He took the money out. So there's nobody. He smiled, you know. He was so happy with himself. He said, I got them. When they were just giving the offerings over there, Judas was watching. Someone was praying and said, I release my faith. I give out a big seed to the Lord. I'm expecting big harvest. And Judas' eyes didn't close. He was just looking. He shook his head. Big seed. Then he got it. Shook it. The bag was heavy. Judas. All right. Took it away. But one day, he got the biggest of them. He said, I can sell the man to you. How much? 30 pieces of silver. Deal? They said, that's too much. He's not worth that much. Jesus. Not what? What? Not what? 30 pieces of silver? They said, he's not worth that much. We want him, but we can't pay that much for him. 30 pieces. He said, okay. It's over. No deal. Oh, they said, oh, come. He said, all right. 30? They said, 30. They counted it. And they said, you get him first, and we give it to you. He said, small. Promise? They said, the promise is a promise. He went out, got Jesus for them. And came back. Hey, where's my money? Where's my money? Hey. They gave it to him. Took the money. And then he was following as they took Jesus away. Read your Bible. He was there from afar. He was watching Jesus. He thought, that miracle man, I know him. He's been telling everybody he's going to die. He's not dying. I know he'll go some mountain somewhere like Elijah. Elijah is to disappear. I know that Jesus. He'll play them out. So when he plays them out, Jesus will escape. And I will escape with the money. And guess what? And then the man fell down. Jesus fell down carrying the cross. Judas' eyes coming out of them sockets now. He thought, hey, he don't mean that, does he? And somebody helped Jesus. He was so weak now. Judas said, that can't be true. By now, he was shaking with the money. And Judas is, no, I know Jesus. And then they took him to the cross. They put the cross down and put Jesus on it. Judas was watching. Hey man, come over that thing. And then they started nailing him. Ah! Judas! He said, it can't be real. Is he crying? Then they lifted it. And Jesus is hanging on the cross. Judas! He wants to cry, but he can't cry. He wants to shout, he can't shout. He don't want nobody to come and arrest him. So, come on, you come on, get off of that thing, man. And Jesus wouldn't. He was looking. And then the man cried. Eloi, Eloi, lema sabachthani. Judas! He's, oh, oh. He ran to the chief priest. He said, hey, let him go, let him go. You can have the money, let him go. They said, nah, we got him, we don't want it. Have what you, he said, hey, don't take the money, let him go, take it. They said, no, we don't want it. Take it, man. They said, no, Judas dropped the money there. And the money scattered and they collected it and bought a piece of land with it. And Judas came out. He said, what can I do? What can I do? What can I do? He ran close to the place. And when he looked, the man took his last cry. Into the hands I commend my spirit. And his head dropped. Judas. He said, I killed him. I sold him. I betrayed him. Oh, I don't have the money. I don't have the man. And then he went, the Bible says, he hanged himself and dropped from the branch. When he fell down, the Bible says his bars came out. He died. Are you still there? Why did Judas do it? He loved money. He didn't know who his source was. Praise God. But Jesus never talked to him about the stealing he was stealing. Because he was so smart, he thought he was smarter than God. And a lot of people are that way. They are smarter than God. He just keeps watching. Until everything... You know, God is patient. He lets you keep running. You run and run and run and run till you can run no more. Then you find him in front of you. Just keep running. Keep playing. The game is still on. But there's only one side. That's you. Because God's not playing games. But you are playing games. And God's looking at you. You're like the trickster. Ain't no minister gonna get my money. They talk about offering and giving. Nobody, no. I'm gonna give anything. God would talk to me. And you never heard the voice of God in your life. But now you wanna hear it about naira and dollars. You're not gonna hear nothing. Because he's been talking to you and you refuse to hear. Say, nobody's gonna get my money. Before I give money, there must be a revelation. You want a revelation? Wait for it. At the rapture of the church, there will be a revelation. Hallelujah. Yep. You want to follow Jesus Christ? You do it from simple things. Simple things. Simple things. That's the way. Do it from simple things. Begin from simple things like this.
Please turn this tape over for the continuation of this message.
God is your source. Amen. Amen. Don't cut off the source. Have time for your source. This is your source. Without him, you're nothing. Without him, that company cannot stand. Have you ever in your life... Oh, some of you know this. You know how to work in that light with God? Have you ever in your life taken your salary? You got, I mean, that whole pay. You just did a business and they paid you everything. And then you said, I'm giving all this to God. Somebody said, whoo! Oh, ah, God says 1/10. Okay. Relax. See, you're going to have to learn how to break out of the rut. You have to learn how to break out of it. Until you break out of it, it'll keep you in bondage. Where you'll be tied to that job that all you get is all you have. But you have to learn how to open the doors of blessing to come in. See, he says, good measure, pressed down, shaken together and running over, shall men give into your bosom. He said, ain't nobody going to give to me. Come on back here. St. Luke's Gospel 15 chapter. Are you ready? We talked about how he spent everything. He got a job, all right? He got a job. 15 verse, 15 chapters in Luke's Gospel. And he went and joined himself to a citizen of that country. And he sent him into his fields to feed swine. Are you there? And he would fain have filled his belly with the husks that the swine did eat. And no man gave unto him. Can you see that? No man gave unto him. Was the result of his spending everything. He never gave. He spent all. He spent everything on himself. He never gave to anybody. So now no man gave to him. Because he gave to no man. Jesus said, give and it shall be given you. And what? Good measure. Pressed down. Shaken together. Running over. Shall men give into your bosom. The man didn't give. Now, no man gave to him. Just nobody would give to him. Well, you say, well, I can't just imagine anybody giving me nothing. Yep, because you haven't known this yet. Now, you start giving. You start giving. And like we said last week, don't just stay giving to your cousin and your uncle and your brother and your aunt and your mother and your father. Only those in your flesh. If you live that way, you are sowing to the flesh. And the Bible says you shall of the flesh reap corruption. The Bible says sow to the spirit. I showed you the other day that this didn't have a reference to sin. Even though you can apply it. But in the context of the Bible, where it was written, it had no reference to sin. It had reference to your giving. It meant giving according to the flesh and giving according to the spirit. And giving according to the flesh meant that you were giving to those who you knew from your flesh only because of that relationship. And there's nothing wrong with that, but remember that giving is something else. You sow to the flesh. Now you give because the word said so. Such that even if you're given to your mother, if you're given to your brother, if you're given to anybody, including your siblings or your children, anybody, let it be based on the word of God. Then you are sowing to the spirit. You see the difference? You start doing that, you'll be amazed. Now, people who don't know you can give you what you didn't expect. Good things. You say, but for my job, how can I? God is bigger than you. That's why he is bigger than you. He can do something you cannot imagine. That's the reason. That's why he is God. He's bigger than you. He's bigger than you. Do you know God talks? Do you know he got a voice? Do you know he can talk to somebody? He's bigger than you. He said, well, I don't believe it. And then you can't see it. Let me show you something. Sure you want to see this? Yeah, you should want to see it. Oh, glory to Jesus. How great thou art. How great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art. How great thou art. Praise God. Listen to this. I want to read this to you. You can ask me who when I'm through. Then Elisha said, hear ye the word of the Lord. There was hunger in the land. There was famine. Everybody was struggling to get something. And the king, he was so sorry for himself and for the land. He said, prophet of God, please do something. And the prophet prophesied. Watch this. Listen. He's prophesying about the economy of the nation changing in 24 hours. That has to be a miracle. In 24 hours, he said, there'll be a change. Watch it. Oh, I like it. Watch it. Then, now you want to know where it is. Okay. 2 Kings, the 7th chapter. It pays to believe. You know what Jesus said to Nathanael? He talked to Nathanael by the word of knowledge. And Nathanael said, hey, he said, you, how did you know that? You are the king of Israel. Jesus said, you believe just because I told you that? He said, yeah. Then Jesus said, you shall see greater things than this. See, when you believe, you see more. Praise the Lord. The guy who says, I don't believe. You don't have to. Chapter 7, verse 1, 2 Kings. Then Elisha said, hear ye the word of the Lord. Thus saith the Lord, tomorrow about this time, 24 hours from now, praise God, shall a measure of fine flour be sold for a shekel, and 2 measures of barley for a shekel in the gate of Samaria. I mean, it's like you telling somebody that tomorrow a bag of rice will be 10 naira. 10. A bag of rice. Somebody say, woo! A bag of rice? What about a bottle of Coke? Praise the Lord. There's a man who was one of the king's henchmen. You understand? He's a big guy. He's close to the king. And he's listening to this prophet and he's shaking his head. Prophet. Watch it. Then a lord on whose hand the king leaned answered the man of God and said, behold, if the Lord would open windows, would make windows in heaven, might this thing be? He said, even if God would open windows in heaven, you understand what I'm talking about? He says, in the gate of Samaria, a bag of rice for 10 naira. He says, even if God were to open windows in heaven, this cannot be. I mean, can't you just be real? Don't you understand the problem in the world? The CBN, the G8, G7, G6, they got a problem all over. Watch it now. Behold, if the Lord will make windows in heaven, might this thing be? What did the prophet say? And he said, behold, thou shalt see it with thine eyes, but shall not eat thereof. What do you think? Hey, what do you think the man would say? Say, get out. Get out. Prophet says, you will see it with your eyes, but you're not going to eat of it. Until we see it now. Oh, king, live forever. Please don't mind this man. Watch how God does his thing. God is, I mean... Hallelujah. When God moves into a situation, he just blows your mind. remember that lady that didn't have, she didn't have a uterus. Now that she got big and went to the doctor, same doctor that performed the operation, and he didn't recognize her. The doctor removed her uterus one time and didn't recognize her. She was big, and she said, Dr. Chapman, because she didn't believe she was pregnant. She said it couldn't be. She said, I'm sick. That's what she said. She said, I'm sick. Because she knew her uterus was taken away. She said, I'm sick. She was born again. Doctor said, you're pregnant. Asked her some questions and said, you're pregnant. She said, doctor, you don't remember me. She said, doctor, I am sick. Doctor got angry. That's how you young girls behave. That's how your pregnant. You say, yo, check my case file. She with his glass. And then he brought it out and was looking. Then he took off. What did you say your name is? Hallelujah. She was pregnant. The doctor could not believe it. He couldn't take it. Because he performed that operation. He took that uterus out. And here's this woman pregnant. He said it's impossible. Well, in no time, she gave birth to a bouncing baby boy. I said, when God moves into a situation, you don't know what to make of it. Hallelujah. See how easy God did this thing. Let's look at it. God got the enemy together. The enemy. They came out against God's people. You understand? I said, every time the devil shows his face, relax. God will ambush the devil. He'll take care of him. And he got the enemy. And Esau was surrounded. And these enemy people, they made their camp. They were just happy with themselves. They're going to take over Esau. They're going to take over. Thinking about how they're going to divide the land to, you know, this general and that other general. They were just so happy. They brought in so much food, so much supplies, and they were getting drunk, and they were so happy with themselves. So much food, so much. Then watch it. Verse 3. And there were four leprous men. Oh, God. Even use kings, he used lepers. I mean, these guys don't have no fingers no more. Do you understand? The fingers are gone, the toes are gone, and these guys are going to be walking like this. Do you understand? I mean, when God wants to fix something, when he wants to put the devil in shame, he would use a baby. Hallelujah. The Bible says there were four leprous men at the entering in of the gate. And they said one to another, why do we sit here until we die? Four men, they were lepers anyway. And if we say we will enter into the city, then the famine is in the city. And we shall die there. And if we sit still here, we die also. Now therefore, come, let us fall into the host of the Syrians. If they save us alive, we shall live. And if they kill us, we shall die too. If we stay here, we die. If we go into the city, we die. Let's just go. There's food in that camp of the enemy. Three guys, they said, we're going to die anyway. So let's go. Hey, why are these guys planning on this? It was the Lord. He was whispering to these guys and telling them what to do. And they just got up and said, let's get out of here. Let's go. If we stay, we die. We move that way, we die. Let's go this way. What? And these four men, verse 5, the Bible says, and they rose up in the twilight to go unto the camp of the Syrians. The Syrians were the enemies. And when they were come to the uttermost part of the camp of Syria, behold, there was no man there. Huh? Think about it. I mean, a whole army of several thousands. And these four guys are coming. They are lepers. No fingers, no toes. And they're coming and hoping that God will save them alive. You understand? They don't have no weapons. And then they've been hearing the noise all year round. These guys have camped. They are living here. Read the Bible. They've been there a long time. And now, we get here. The whole camp is empty. But every morning, they heard the sound of the trumpet getting the soldiers ready. They were practicing. And now we come here. Nobody in the camp. They left their food. Everything. Watch what happened. Now he wants to tell us what happened. Where went them soldiers? For the Lord, verse 6, for the Lord had made the hosts of the Syrians to hear a noise of chariots and a noise of horses, even the noise of a great host. And they said one to another, lo, the king of Israel hath hired against us the kings of the Hittites and the kings of the Egyptians to come upon us. Wherefore they rose and fled in the twilight and left their tents and their horses and their asses, even the camp as it was, and fled for their lives. As those four men were coming, God amplified the sound. It sounded as though a great host was coming. They couldn't wait long enough to mount the horses. They couldn't mount the horses. It would be too late to climb any horse. They had to run with their legs. And they fled everyone. Look at this. This is beautiful. Verse 8. And when these lepers came to the outermost part of the camp, they went into one tent and did eat and drink. And raiment, and carried things. They carried silver and gold and raiment, and went and hid it, and came again and entered into another tent, and carried things also, and went and hid it. Then they said one to another, "We are not doing well." They said, "This day is a day of good tidings." Hallelujah. And we hold our peace. If we tarry till the morning light, some mischief will come upon us. Now therefore come, that we may go and tell the king's household. So they came and called unto the porter of the city, and they told them, saying, we came to the camp of the Syrians, and behold, there was no man there, neither voice of man, but horses tied and asses tied, and the tents as they were. And he called the potters, and they told it to the king's house within. And the king arose in the night and said unto his servants, I will now show you what the Syrians have done to us. Look up, all of you. Look up. Look at this skeptic king. See, some people are just that way. They can only think of everything negative. When you tell them to make an investment, they say, everybody's losing. You say, put your money in the bank. They say, all the banks are failing. You say, okay, get a job. They say, nobody's job is secure anymore. Okay, what do you want to do? He wouldn't take a new course. I'm too old. I mean, any suggestion you make, he has something else to tell you. Mm-mm. That's the way this king was. The king said, I know what's happening. Let me tell you what. He didn't know nothing. Listen to this. And the king arose, verse 12, in the night and said unto his servants, I will now show you what the Syrians have done to us. They know that we are hungry. Therefore, they are gone out of the camp to hide themselves in the field, saying, when they come out of the city, we shall catch them alive and get into the city. But was that what happened? No. This man was the king that the prophet told, watch out. But you see, he didn't know how God was going to do it. Brothers and sisters, you may never be able to figure out in your mind how God works. Hallelujah. Listen to this. And one of his servants answered and said, let some take, I pray thee, five of the horses that remain which are left in the city. Behold, they are as all the multitude of Israel that are left in it. Behold, I say, they are even as all the multitude of the Israelites that are consumed. And let us send and see. They took therefore two chariot horses. And the king sent after the host of the Syrians, saying, go and see. And they went after them unto Jordan, and lo, all the way was full of garments and vessels which the Syrians had cast away in their haste. And the messengers returned and told the king, and the people went out and spoiled, that is, they took. They carried everything they got in the tents of the Syrians. So a measure of fine flour was sold for a shekel, and 2 measures of barley for a shekel, according to the word of the Lord. What about that Mr. Big Man, Mr. Big Shot, sitting close to the king that day? And the king appointed the Lord on whose hand he leaned. You remember that guy? He was now appointed to have the charge of the gates. He should take charge, you know, as people are coming, so they're coming to buy. So, Mr. Unbeliever, he was now told, you stay at the gate, and then you organize the people. So he's there to actually see this thing happening. Elisha, that guy, he's a real prophet, you know. He's a real prophet. So I didn't believe him, but he's a real prophet. Now he's believing because he's going to eat something now. See, but watch what happens to him. And the king appointed, verse 17, the Lord on whose hand he leaned to have charge of the gate. And the people trod upon him in the gate, and he died as the man of God had said, who spake when the king came down to. He died. He saw it. The people were so many as they were rushing to come get it, and they stepped on him. The rush was too much. The man saw and he died. He didn't eat of it. Why? For unbelieving. What is the conclusion of the whole matter? Let me read it to you. I want to read it to you. Oh, thank you, Lord Jesus. Ecclesiastes chapter 11. Are you ready? Verse 4. He that observeth the wind shall not sow, and he that regardeth the cloud shall not reap. As thou knowest not what is the way of the spirit, nor how the bones do grow in the womb of her that is with child. You don't know how the bones grow in the womb of a woman that's pregnant. Even so thou knowest not the works of God who make it all. In the morning sow thy seed, and in the evening withhold not thine hand. For thou knowest not whether shall prosper, either this or that, or whether they both shall be alike good. Hello.
Hi.
You're going to sow your seed. Amen.
Amen.
Sow your seed. For whatever you require in your life, whatever you need, do it continuously. Make it your lifestyle, and you will never run dry. If your business is down today, sow a seed for your business. Now you know God is your source. That job is not your source. God is your source. If you let him take care of you, you will never go empty. This is his word. Amen?
Amen.
This is what your life should be like. Put your trust in God and not on anybody. Learn to plant seeds and then expect the harvest. No farmer sows without expecting a harvest. Learn to expect a harvest. Expect a harvest. Expect it. Because when you expect it, you will be grateful. Because when it shows up, you're going to know that it's come, and you're going to be thankful. Those that do not expect, when it happens, they don't recognize it. Therefore, they are not thankful. Which means they will not see more. See? So more miracles will not happen for them. Make your living on your giving. Amen?
Amen.
The Bible says, he that soweth sparingly shall reap also sparingly. If you need a lot of money because you have a lot of dependents, you have a lot that you've got to do, so big what you need, because it says your reaping, your harvest will be equivalent to your sowing. That's what it says. Your harvest will be equivalent to your sowing. Hallelujah. Sometimes what you need or what you want may not be money. It could be some other things. Maybe not material. There are lots and lots of other things in life. What you would learn. For example, if you want a child, so what are you going to do? Are you going to plant a half hand or something? How are you going to do it? You have to study in the Word and see what is it that you need. You're in need of something. You want a child. So you're in need of something that you may not be able to sow itself. You can't sow a seed of the child itself. Several things you can do. Number one, treat other people's kids good. Because someone will have to treat your kids good. And since they have to treat your kids good, you don't have no kids, the kids have to come. Are you catching it? It's a principle. Oh, praise God. I could give you wonderful testimonies. How God has done so much in the lives of many. So that's one of the things you could do. There's another thing you could do, which is here in the Word of God. But you know, I will have to read all that to you, but not tonight. So I'll skip that for now. But anything that you want in your life, plant a seed. Plant a seed, because you're going to get of the same kind that you sow. You will not get something different. In the afternoon, I mentioned to them that one of the reasons why you sow money seeds is because money represents you more than anything else. Because money represents your character. Because, you know, money can't do nothing. Money can only do what the user will do. So it represents your character. It represents your person. It represents your skill, your labor, your time. When you're paid, when you have money, when you receive money, you get money for what you have done. So it's your talents, your time, your labor, all of that quantified in monetary terms. Okay? That's what that money is. It is the medium of exchange. Okay? So, and then it can answer for any other thing. It can answer for anything, because you could use the money for anything else. All right? And then also, it is easier for us to give away things than to give away money. So the challenge is stronger about money. So a lot of times, it is better to give money. In other words, now, why did I say that? It means, if you had no money, and you had two pairs of shoes, for example, it would be wrong for you to say, oh God, I don't have anything to give. Or to take that shoe and bring it and say, God, you know, I got only these shoes. You know what? No. Go sell the shoes. Sell the shoes for whatever it's worth. And give the money. Hey, why did I tell you that? Don't forget Cain and Abel. Abel offered to God the right sacrifice. Cain had a different attitude. He said, I give him what I have. And God said, you're wrong. So, don't say, I give him what I have. For example, you have two shirts. You don't have money. Take one. That one, it's unlikely that somebody is going to like to wear that shirt. It may take us a long time to get somebody to wear it. And as long as we have it, we can do nothing with it. That shirt is not sown like you think. Because you brought something to God that had almost no value to you. What do you do? Take the shirt. Go out there where they sell used things. Say, I want to sell this shirt to you. The guy says, what's all this? It's not from Europe. Say, well, it's from my body. But I didn't have money. How much would you like to buy it? And the guy says, 10 naira. Say, 20. 15. Anyway, at the end, you come to a compromise. Whatever then it's worth, I tell you, when you sell it, you will have the temptation to use this money. That tells you it is of value, because the devil wants to get it. Can you see it now? He didn't want your shirt, but now you turn it into money, and the devil, hunger comes. You can buy a loaf of bread. Hey, come on, get a drink. Now everything is calling for that money. It may be only 50 naira. Buy a newspaper. Have you seen people who just buy anything as they're going? There's a lady with ground nuts. As they're going, there's ice cream here. Even with their cars. Hold up, they drive a little. Then somebody says, hey, hey, hey. Then they wind down and say, let me see. They buy this. The other one says, hanky, hanky. He has hanky there. Say, this one is getting... You buy it. There's new bread from Ghana. From Ghana. Ghana bread. You buy it. Hallelujah. You know what that is? Can I tell you what it is? That is the devourer. You think the devourer is one... The Bible says he will rebuke the devourer for your sake. You think the devourer is one... Knock, knock. I am Mr. Devourer. No, he comes while you're ironing. He just bounces it. Say, this is my new shirt. That's Mr. Devourer right there. Your car just got carburetor every time. Carburetor, carburetor. Devourer is around. Now you know what I'm talking about. Okay. Matter of time. Praise God.
Sống nhân thế muôn ngày sau vẫy gọi. tàn giông bão niềm đau còn đọng lại, chờ trong khi rượu vợi tình ta. Ai hẹn đâu mà mắt đẫm lệ nhòa, thương ra giết cuộc tình xa vạn dặm.
Thank you.